Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I am your host, Jason Turner. I'm available for code reviews and on-site training. In this episode, I want to talk a little bit about my personal vendetta against Lisp. Be sure to check out this video description for any links to upcoming events. I'm planning to give training at NDC Tech Town in September on C++ best practices, and hopefully at CVPCon as well. So if you are watching this video before September of 2023, definitely check those things out. So when I was in university, I took a class called, I believe, Comparative Languages while I was working on my computer science degree. And we used this book, The Concepts of Programming Languages. And in fact, I still have my copy. My copy is the third edition. They are currently on the 12th edition, which gives you some idea how long ago I took Comparative Languages. Now, this book and the course that was associated with it talk about Lisp. And Lisp, that particular project, is the only project in my entire computer science curriculum that I was not able to complete. I just could not quite wrap my mind around the necessary constructs for recursive-only programming effectively for Lisp processing. And that's kind of always stuck with me. Now, I'm not going to say that I do understand Lisp today, but I was inspired to work on this a little bit. Now, you are probably aware that JT, my cousin, and I worked on ChiScript many years ago. You can see the last commits to it were 2 years ago, and the actual full language history goes well back to some 13, 14 years ago. And ChiScript is awesome. It is a great embedded scripting language for C++. And the very most simple way of using it is incredibly straightforward. I can declare a function in C++. I can create an instance of the ChiScript engine. I can add this function. And then I can eval a function and get the result back. But there are a lot of design decisions that I made in ChiScript that I would simply not make today. There's just really no way that you could do constexpr evaluation, for example. I wanted to right this wrong and start anew. Which brings us to constexpr. This is a constexpr-friendly embedded scripting language for C++ that I've been working on for a couple of months now. And it is a play on the fact that it is constexpr-capable. It is S-expressions like Lisp and Scheme. And if you're familiar with that family of languages, there's the constcutter thing, where you use those statements for list processing. So here you go. This is on GitHub. You can check it out. I will give you a quick little rundown of some examples. First of all, I want to point out that the entire test suite, well, almost the entire test suite, is actually run at compile time and runtime. So if you want to, you can check through this test suite and you can see the kinds of things that we can do. We can evaluate the statement at compile time and get back a long double at compile time and check to see that it is in fact the value that I expect it to be at compile time. Now, you might be curious why that's a long double. We'll get into that in just a moment. I do support the common define, lambda, let, and do statements, because these are all of the things that can introduce a new lexical scope for variables in Scheme. In my language, in constexpr, anything that is captured at runtime becomes a runtime constant. I actually rebuild the S expression so that all of the constants that are known are swapped out. And this results in some better performing and interesting properties of the code, which we might play with in a moment here. Now, if you dig down into the compiletest.cpp in the examples folder, you will see some of the bidirectional things that we can do. Now, I want to point out that this is a const eval function, so this function must be executed at compile time. We create an instance of the evaluator. Now, it has these empty template parameters, which we'll talk about in just a moment. And so I am at compile time, creating an instance of the evaluator. I'm adding this function called add. This is a C++ function that adds two long longs together. And I am declaring this function called sum, which is a lambda, in my scheme-like script. And I am evaluating this thing. And this needs some cleanup. I need to do some cleanup here. But basically, I'm saying make a callable that returns a long long and takes two long longs. It is going to reference the defined object sum. And I am going to bind that up with bind front. And I'm going to return this. Now, keep in mind, this all happens at compile time. So this func could be constexpr, except for the fact that I wouldn't be able to call it because it's required to be mutable. But this thing right here has generated at compile time a fully bound up object that is the scripting engine and the scripted function, and then we can execute this thing at runtime. Okay, that's enough of the general use and examples. I feel like I tried to make it almost as easy to use as ChiScript. I am doing my absolute best to keep the code as succinct as possible. It is still longer than I want it to be, but the entire engine, parser, executor, all the things are 1,416 lines right now. I want to simplify that as much as I can. There's still some cleanups that need to happen. Okay, let's talk about those empty template parameters. I tried to make this as generic and usable as possible. So size type for indexes into the elements in the scripting runtime is configurable. And by default, it is a uint 16. I made this decision so that it would be possible to compact the size of objects a little bit more in the system, if possible, to make it all a little bit more cache friendly. If you knew that you were never going to do anything more than 255 elements large, then you could make your size type a uint 8 if you were so inclined. Char type is configurable in case you want to use wide characters of some sort. The integral type, so this is the parsed type, is by default long long. I'm probably going to change that back to int, but I did this for experimentation. And the default parsed float type is a long double. Now these things, built-in symbols, built-in strings, and built-in values, these are the stack objects that contain the known defined symbols, the current values that are owned and managed by the system, and the number of characters in the string table. So since everything is immutable, the runtime knows that it can reuse any string of symbols or characters that it needs to when creating new lists. And this, again, makes it all a little bit more memory compact. So I think we've got some good opportunity there as well for some interesting, possibly, plausibly, for perhaps very small devices, but I haven't experimented with that yet. And then you have a variadic set of user-defined types that this is allowed to work with. As a quick aside, you can, again, see how easy it is to just add a C++ function. Now, it must be a template parameter, the function that you pass in, and the name that you want it to have. So we can now see also how this user-defined type list is used. And I need to simplify what it means to use the rest of these template parameters. But I have declared a local struct called test. It has set and get members. And I have told the evaluator at compile time that I'm going to work with test pointers. And then I have the set and get functions that I have registered. And you can see here this bidirectional interoperability. I am kind of ish requiring that you pass in pointers if you want mutable objects from C++. You could use reference wrapper if you wanted to, but that would be a design decision on your side for how you actually use this. But I am creating a test object, I am assigning initial value, I am putting a pointer to it called myobj inside the system, and then I am able to interact bidirectionally with these values between constexpr and the C++ runtime. Now, in the process of developing and working on this thing, I created this little UI using FTX UI, which I have talked about in other episodes, to look at the full set of all of the things that are going on here. So on the left side of the screen where I'm scrolling right now is the current string table. We're using 74 characters. And we have 26 symbols used. I don't have the symbol table displayed yet here in the UI, and zero values. So if I'm going to go ahead and do something like, I have declared a lambda. It takes a single parameter called x and it adds 42 to x. So if I evaluate this, nothing really happens. I've created the lambda, and you can see here where I did that whole replacement of things that were known at the time that the object was created. So now this is a function pointer to this memory address, which is the plus function and the value x and 42. Now, if I were to declare a global called y, and I wanted to make this x plus y plus 42 and evaluate this again, then I am actually going to see that again, the whole s expression is rewritten and I have this thing called nothing, it is anonymous lambda, that is some sort of function pointer, and x, and 23, and 42. So if I evaluate this again, I'm going to get rid of this. The number of symbols created doesn't expand because I already know that I have evaluated this thing before. So let's go ahead and just evaluate the symbol L. And if I evaluate that, then I can see over here these outputs have been going along this whole time. And I can see that the symbol L has the parameters 0 and 1, which is right here, 0 for a length of 1. So that is the parameter is x is an identifier, which is identified in the string table by position 74. And 74 is the x. And it consists of the statements 28, comma 1, so just one statement, line 28, and this is the statement. It is a function pointer that plus with x 23, 42. So let's go ahead and add 10 to 23 and 42. I need to do constant folding. I could add that 23 and 42 at parse time. I haven't gotten there yet. Evaluate that, and if we scroll back over here, we can see the result is 75. All right, so a fun little debug tool, a fun little language, embeddable for C++. I don't know. It's something that I spent the last couple of weeks doing. Be sure to check this out if you have any interest in this whatsoever. My goal is to keep the code as simple and as clean as possible so that we can use it as a test bed for C++ 23 features, and so that other people can read the code and learn from it as well. So thank you for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Be sure to subscribe.